Hey, what's up, everybody? Are we live? We're live. I see the live sticker, so I guess that means we're live. Welcome to the Visual Studio Code weekly live stream. Today, is this a release party? Holy crap, it's a release party. We do so many release parties, I lose track. Yes, we have a release party. What's up, chat? Thanks for being here. Let's see. Awesome. I hope there are some new features this time. There's always new features. We got you. Don't worry about it. Now, listen, you know the drill before we get started. If you're on YouTube, then you're already in the right place to hit that subscribe button. You're going to go ahead and do that. It's going to feel good to do it. So just do it. There we go, right there. Also, check us out on TikTok. Hang out with us there at tiktok.com/@VSCode. Correct. We do a lot of dances. And then lastly, what's the last thing we do? Oh, meetup. That's right. We have a meetup group. We'd love you we'd love for you to join us there. Look, it's Thursday and I'm moving slow. But we have a release party today, which means we got a lot of new stuff to cover with y'all. Yes, lots of new features. I don't know. What should we do, chat? I feel like we should kick this off with some sort of like all participation thing. What sort of question should we ask? Your time zone. Put your time zone in. Where are you at? Who's up at 4 a.m? I want to know. That's dedication. All right. So we've got a great release party for you today. We got some very special guests. I see them. Y'all can't see them, but I see them all down here in the tray, waiting patiently to come on the live stream. So with that, let me make sure I didn't miss any notes. I didn't, producer. I got them all. All right. So coming right up, the first thing that we're gonna do. Is our schedule staying the same? Are we good? Okay, good. I got the thumbs up. Listen, it's a well-oiled machine we run here, y'all. First up, we're going to talk about Liveshare in vscode.dev. And to do that, I'm going to welcome Felicia to the stage. What is
up? Hey, Bird. It's early, but it's good.
What time is it? What is it, like 8 a.m. where you are?
Yeah, but it's, you know, winter time, so the sun's barely up.
Have to move to a proper time zone, like Central Standard Time, where it's a comfortable 10 a.m.
Yep.
We got people joining from all over. We got Sue Boys from Vietnam. Ravi joining from Nepal. John from Nairobi, Kenya. What's up, everybody?
Hello.
Kankaj from the Czech Republic. Matt Haroon says, hey, Felicia, what's up?
Hello. You know, I'm excited to be showing vscode.dev live show today.
All right. Well, as early as it is, let's do it.
Okay. Well, so getting into it, Burke, we are going to talk about Liveshare. Everybody probably knows about this. If you use VS Code, it's an extension that exists on VS Code. So I'm going to share my screen now and show you what we've added. And it's a pretty neat thing. Let's see. Sharing my screen. All right. Can you see my screen?
Yes, we can.
Okay. So
what theme is that, Felicia? Before we get started, because people are asking me the first thing they ask, let's just get that out of the way.
Well, I have no idea. I use the Peacock extension and then it like gives me all these fancy colors, right?
So I gotcha.
Yeah. Right. You know, I highly recommend that extension though. So, you know, VS Code, this is a regular desktop stable extension. We have Liveshare in the marketplace. My Liveshare is, right here, it's downloaded. I started Liveshare session, which is a real-time collaboration session that shares not just your screen, but your entire editor context. You're able to do lots of cool stuff, right? So this is a regular session that I'm starting within Visual Studio Code. It gives me a link. Now, and this link is what I would use typically to join from another VS Code instance or maybe the browser. Today now, we've changed this to have ability, it's supported in vscode.dev too. Initially, it was just desktop to desktop, and then we had desktop to browser, right? So if I go and I'm just right here, I can just paste this link into the browser and it's opened up in vscode.dev and it's going to try and join the session. And this is just a regular experience that we had last year. Now, the cool thing, though, is we've added sharing from the browser. Now, imagine I go directly to vscode.dev. I have my setting sync on, which is why it's, and this is my GitHub. There's another avatar that I have called Scout Cookie. Don't even ask me why. So I already have Liveshare installed. If you don't have your setting sync on with, hold on. I thought my setting sync was on, but I'm signed out. But if you don't have your setting sync on, I would highly recommend turning it on, because what it does is it takes all your VS Code instances. Oh, there it is. I am signed in now. It takes all your extensions and it like makes sure that they're there in vscode.dev. So now I have Liveshare in vscode.dev. I can share now from Liveshare, which is the coolest part. I can share, and I just started a Liveshare session. Obviously, you probably want to open a file or repository before doing that. So let's just start open a repository from GitHub. So let me just open, this pull request that I have. Let's see. Hopefully you guys can't see my password. Oops, let's do this one. All right. Let's see, is that opening? You know, I'm gonna try again.
I see that sometimes too, when I'm trying to open from GitHub, if I'm not signed in correctly for some reason.
Oh, there it is. Okay. Yeah. I think it was just waiting for me to, weird. Maybe, you know, there's something weird happening. Maybe I'll open another repository. Hold on. Let me just do this one.
It's because you're on a live stream.
Yes.
gods have frowned on you.
Well, this one seems to be doing better. There was something weird happening with that repository. You know what? I know what it is. It's because I'm signed into this account. I need to sign into another account, you know? Sorry, guys.
Always account. We got to get rid of passwords and sign-ins. I don't know how we're going to do that. Chat, give us some ideas. What can we do instead of never enter password again?
Yeah. You know, this is what happens when I have like multiple GitHub accounts. And let me just quickly try and use my other account. Because you know what it's doing is trying to find this repository that's in my, you know what? I'm going to instead try and open a local file. Hold on. Let's do that.
So let's see, Mirza said change the password today only. I don't know what that means. Sure, we could change face ID. Yeah, Ryan, that's a good point. Biometric.
Sure. Okay, well, let's try and... Well, let me do this, all right? Liveshare works even without me opening. Oh, there it is. Okay. Let me now change. It's still going to use my Scout key. Anyway, so I start a Liveshare session from within the browser. The cool thing is that you can imagine I have a whole, this is like a file that I have open. I have an entire repository, whatever context you're working in, you know, you have, you're working on a web app, you're working on Python, whatever it is that you're doing. And now I can live share from the browser to the browser. So now I created a live share session from vscode.dev. You saw that. I'm joining that session from vscode.dev itself, right? So you can have an entire collaboration session from just your browser, right? You don't need the desktop application. Of course, you probably want to do it if you want to do things like terminal and debugging. But this is super powerful because you're able to just quickly get in and out of sessions. Imagine you're in the classroom, you know, you are like your professor is teaching you something, or you like you are, I don't know, somewhere trying to collaborate. You are on a different mission. You're in a lab. You're a student. You want to like get into like a group project with a fellow, you know, student. You can just use vscode.dev as almost like, I think of it as like my live share playground. I can get in and out of sessions. I can also, right, like obviously I can do all the things like following somebody around, you know, here if I am this person, and this is all the regular live share features it comes with. And the tricky thing about always streaming live share is I need to have like two windows open all the time. So here it is, right? So let's say I am, you can see that on the guest side, Scout Cookie, which is my name, is, you know, showing what they're at. So we have all these like cool regular Liveshare features. Now, what if you were like, I want to, you know, debug my app. I want to do something else. I want to access the terminal. You know, I'm done with like co-editing and things like that. Well, you can very easily like continue working on. And that's a really, that's basically our way of like allowing you to like either open it in desktop or like going to code spaces. So if you need the full power of, you know, you can also do this and you can show open in desktop, open in VS Code, right? So you can just switch. I don't know why it's not showing up the Liveshare open. You should be able to like switch into like going to the VS Code desktop app. And that's essentially all I wanted to show you. I wanted to show you how you could use vscode.dev to start a session now and join a session and have a full collaboration session within just the browser.
Yeah, so this is awesome. We've got a couple of questions in here. One of them was really good. And I think it's kind of the question that anyone, because Liveshare is not new. So the question is, Sajad asked, isn't it better to use the desktop application than the browser version of VS Code for Liveshare? And I have my own opinion on that, but I'll let you answer, Felicia.
That's actually a good question, right? So obviously, was it John who asked that question? Well, I think there are different applications for that. There are two different types of users. Obviously, if you have desktop, you know, locked and loaded and you have your everyday work laptop or whatever it is that you're working on, great. You know, you can always use that. This works really well. But vscode.dev for us is more about like an ease of use tool. It's especially for people who are trying out VS Code. It's for people who perhaps are not working from a familiar machine, or if you change your machine a lot all the time, you don't want to do all the setup. You know, you want to get in and out. Perhaps you're like just reviewing a pull request and you want to like collaborate on that. You don't want to really have to like open up VS Code desktop. So it's an option that we like to have. A lot of people, you know, if you're on a Chromebook, if you don't have a machine that can actually support desktop applications. So yeah, one of the things that we wanted was to be able to have an end-to-end flow and make it accessible to everybody in all different types of like, you know, types of machines and types of situations. Yeah.
Yeah, that makes sense. And Felicia, I've noticed that I prefer this experience over opening it in the desktop. And let me tell you why, Chat. It's because when people ask me to live share, if they send me a link, it just opens in the browser. I don't want another instance of VS Code opened if I don't need to have one open. It takes up VS Code is a running process on your computer, right? So the more instances you have, the more resources that it's consuming. But more than that, it's a very casual thing for me where like I'm just in a browser tab and then I'm out and I'm done. I mean, it's almost like a window into somebody else's environment on LiveShare. And it's super fast for me.
It's super fast.
It's really fast. So I really prefer LiveShare in the browser if I'm the one who's sharing to somebody else's. Now, if I was the one sharing my project, I might be in desktop VS Code, right? Because I'm doing hardcore work at that point. But as the joiner, I love LiveShare in the browser, and y'all got to check that out. It's awesome. All right, Felicia, well, thank you so much for being with us early, early, early in the morning.
Thank you. Well, if you have any other questions, I can answer in the chat. Thanks, Burke.
All right. Thanks, Felicia. See ya. All right, folks, moving right along. We've got a lot to cover. Next, we're going to talk about the bracket colorization in Visual Studio Code. Now, this is an interesting topic. And the bracket pair colorizer was an extension that existed for VS Code before. It was super popular. It was very popular. It's now a built-in feature to VS Code. And here to discuss that is Henning Dietrichs. What's up, Henning?
Hi, nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you. Yeah, Henning and I are meeting for the first time, right? This is it. The first interaction. Henning is the engineer who implemented this feature in VS Code, and is going to talk about some of the new features and a little bit of history as well. So I guess you are going to go into like, why did we do that? Why wasn't the extension good enough? And like, how did we get here?
Yeah. So when my screen share takes over. Yeah, you probably have heard of the bracket pair colorizer extension by Conrad S. It's a super popular and awesome extension with over 6 million installs. And it has been out there for over, I think, 5 years. And it's maybe one of the first extensions there. And it's awesome. You should check it out. But it has one tiny problem. It has a performance issue. And this performance issue is not due to the way how this extension is coded, but due to limitations of extensions in general. Because for very large documents with like 100,000s of lines, things can get slow. For example, here, if I add a bracket at the beginning, you see the colors don't update immediately, but only after some time. You see, it still updates and updates and updates. And only now the colors updated. And this is because it's an extension. But in the core of vscode, we can do better. And let me show you what we did. So with the release 2 months ago, there has been a new setting, editor.bracketpaircolorization.enabled, which is false by default. But if you set it to true, then you can see color that brackets are now colorized. And these colors make it really easy to see which brackets match. For example, this this bracket here in yellow match this one and so on. It's a really nice tool. And the thing now is we made it fast, like really, really fast. For example, here we have a document with 100K lines, and it has insane amount of brackets. You can see it here, insane amount. But if I add brackets here, it updates immediately at the end. You can see it, the color updates immediately. And if I even paste multiple brackets at once, you can see it updates so quickly that it's, yeah, you have.
There's so many brackets. Is this PHP? I'm sorry.
No, this is just TXT. It's a demo.
It's a PHP joke, Chad. It's okay. Relax. All right.
I see. So this feature is old. And last month, we introduced bracket pair guides. And let me go to this demo here. Bracket pair guides are also implemented in the original extension, but we only added this last month. And if I enable bracket pair guides, then you can see these vertical lines that make it even easier to track which brackets match, which do not. So what is new now, this release, is that there are now also horizontal guides. And I can enable them by setting this here to true. And now you can see there are these horizontal guides. And now it's really a region that shows you where you currently are in. Like this is this bracket. And now if I go here, then you can see this is highlighted. And you can even say that these horizontal guides should only be shown for the active bracket pair. So then these horizontal guides are only shown when for the current block that you're in. And the same setting is also available for these vertical guides. You can change the setting from true here also to active. And now only guides for the active bracket pair are shown.
Oh my gosh, that's so cool. Henning, you got to make a TikTok for this as well. People loved your last one so much. I had no idea you could do this. This is so neat.
Yeah, would love to. Something that is also new with this release is that the indentation is now finally being considered. So let me enable guides for everything, which is my favorite setting here. So you can see that this X here is way before the indentation where it should be. And if that is the case, then these guides adapt. And these horizontal guides really show what the scope of this block is. And this works nicely for real world code like this, where you have a lot of brackets and it's super performant.
Wow, look at that.
What we also have is we have extensive customization options for colors. So you can tweak the colors for the simple bracket pair colorization, but you can also tweak the colors for these guides. And this is new with today's release. You can now see that, I hope you can see that this yellow is a little bit different. If I undo this, you can see it's now
orange.
Yeah. And now it's yellow again. So you can tweak all the colors that you see here. And you can even create custom themes that, that override all these colors. And then something else that is also new and related to this bracket pair colorization feature is you can now finally tweak the brackets in your settings. So for example, I have this txt file, which by default has no brackets configured. But you can now say, hey, for plain text, editor.language.colorize bracket pairs, I want to have these brackets. For example, here now, the curly bracket is being colorized, but I can disable that by commenting it out. And I can even, it even supports like textual brackets, like from begin to end. And now you can see when I save it, that these are no longer being colorized, but now we have begin end, which is colorized, and even has this bracket pair guide.
Jeez, man, bracket pair colorization is becoming an entire like field of study.
Yes,
all on indeed. Its own. That's crazy. So lots of comments from the chat, but people are like, is this already released? Is it released, Henning? Can people use it today?
So this feature is, of course, in the latest Insider, and it will be released with today's vscode release.
Awesome. And John had this question. Docs, got docs on this, Henning? Did you write the docs?
Yeah, I think so. But to use this feature, you really only need to turn on this setting, like editor.guides.bracketpairs, and set it to true. And then this other setting for bracket pair guides. Sorry, this was the setting for bracket pair guides. So editor.guides, this is the setting for guides. And the other setting is editor.bracketpaircolorization for the colorization. These are the only two settings you need.
Nice. Well, thank you so much for being here, Henning. Also, everybody, check out Henning did an article on our blog. If you want to read a very technical explanation of how this actually works, I think it was like on the front. It was on the front page of Hacker News. I don't know if it was number one or not for a while, but it's extremely interesting. If you want to hear about how this was implemented, you should check that. That's on our blog, right, Henning?
Yeah, that's the beauty of computer science.
Right. Exactly. Fascinating stuff there. There it is right there. Thank you, producer. All right, Henning, thank you so much for being here. Thank you for your work on the bracket pair colorization. All of those of us who like colors, which is everybody, thank you for your diligent effort. Thank you. All right, folks, moving right along. What time is it? It's 8:23, depending on where you are. And so we've saved the best for last. I always say that, but it's true. And so I would like to now welcome Chris Gill to the stream to talk about something that a lot of y'all have asked about. And we want to talk to you about what we're doing there. And it's on extension verification. What's up, Chris? Welcome to the live stream.
Hey, Burke. Thanks for having me here.
Yeah, man. So extension verification, what exactly are we talking about there? And why does everybody seem to care so much?
Sure. Rather than explain it, let me share my screen so I can show everyone exactly what it means.
Waiting for the screen share.
There it is. There we go. Can everyone see it?
Yep.
All right. Awesome. I don't know. I was kind of expecting like an audience to go like, yeah, we can see it.
There's I guess that's what Clubhouse is, right? Like Clubhouse is like streaming but with audio. We should add audio. Chat, you want audio? Should we allow skip like an active audience? I don't know. Go ahead, Chris. I'm sorry, man.
No problem. So yeah, so what we mean when we say verified publishers in VS Code is that a publisher has verified ownership of a domain associated with their identity or their brand. So here I'm using an example from GitLens, a very popular VS Code extension that many of you are probably familiar with. You can see that the publisher is GitKraken. But let's say I was a little concerned that anyone could make a publisher named GitKraken, for example, right? And release a extension with a really similar name. Or I just wasn't familiar with who GitKraken was and I wanted to double check. Hey, is this a reputable publisher? Is this a, you know, like a big company, or is it someone I can trust? that's where verified publishers comes in. So I can very easily, so one, I can see a pretty cool looking check mark next to the publisher name that immediately kind of gives me a feeling of trust. But if I'm curious to see what that means, I can just hover over the extension and I can see, oh, lost my blurb. Here we go. Aha. There we go. I can see a little blurb that says this publisher has verified ownership of gitkraken.com. And if I wanted to learn more about this company, I could very easily go to gitkraken.com with a one click of a button, and I can see what they're all about. And I can kind of make my own trust decision there. Similarly, I can see the same like verification indicator on the details page. I can hover over it and see a little tooltip that tells me this publisher has verified ownership of gitkraken.com. And ultimately, that's really what it is. It just means that you verified some domain that kind of reinforces who you are. And that way you can very easily go to their landing page, or if you're an individual publisher, you can even go to their professional website to see their portfolio and give them an opportunity to tell their story of who they are and why you should trust them and use their extensions.
So would it be correct then to assume, Chris, that in order for GitKraken to get this verification, they have to prove that they own that domain somehow before they can get that verification?
That's exactly right. So the way it works is that we use a TXT record verification system, which is pretty common. GitHub actually does the exact same thing. So if you've ever gone to GitHub or to like a GitHub organization to their main page and seen a little verified, like a little green verified button or something like that. If you go to the Microsoft GitHub page right now, that's what you'll see. If you click on the verified button, you'll see a dropdown that tells you what domains that they verified. So the way it works is that, or the way it will work for the Visual Studio Marketplace, is that you'll go to your publisher management. Actually, I can show you exactly what it'll look like. All right. Can everyone see this?
Yes, we can.
So if you are a extension publisher and you have already a publisher that exists on the Visual Studio Marketplace, then you're probably familiar with a page that looks like this. This is kind of what you get when you're first creating your publisher that gives you the opportunity to add your name and your unique ID. And pretty soon we're going to have a verified domain field available there where you can input your domain. As soon as you click verify, you'll get this notification here that tells you what steps you have to take. So the way it works is that you go to your DNS or your domain name service. So that could be like HostGator or for whatever reason, I'm blanking on the different hosts that exist.
I like that
today,
you picked HostGator. That's great. My brother-in-law used to work there.
Okay, that's awesome.
Yeah.
And you just create a TXT record. We're going to tell you what to name the TXT record. We're going to give you a unique value to input it. And then once those changes have reflected, you can verify your domain. All we'll do is double check that TXT record exists at your DNS. And once we verify that, you'll get the check mark immediately.
Awesome. So that is, I guess that's now the question, is that's how you verify your publisher. So chat's got some ideas here, which I think this is quite interesting. So Washif says, I'm very used to the blue tick mark being on the right, I suppose, because of Twitter. Left feels kind of unfamiliar. Chris, they don't like the placement of the of the blue badge.
Yeah. So I can, yeah, that's great feedback. So the reason why we put it on the left is that it's always kind of on the same spot whenever we look at an extension, right? As opposed to if you have some extension publishers with really long names, for example, you might see the check mark being all the way off to the right, or it might even cut off the publisher name. So that's kind of the reason for that. I know it looks a little bit jarring to some people, but you know, if you feel really strongly about it, feel free to leave us feedback.
Move the blue badge to the right. Okay, that's interesting. So here's a question. I don't fully understand this. Uomo says, you see, you prove that you own the domain by modifying the DNS entry of your domain. I'm not sure if right. they're putting out like a security thing or if they're just sort of, do you understand that?
So at your DNS configuration, you can add all sorts of records, right? One of those types of records is a TXT record. It's pretty common to add a TXT record with a specific code to verify that you own that domain. And basically it just shows that you control that domain to the point where you can modify the DNS configuration. There's not any security risk that I'm aware of adding a TXT record. TXT records are all public. So if I can go to a DNS lookup website and I can type in Microsoft.com and see all of the records that exist at Microsoft.com, for example. Right. And you'll probably see several like verifications for Google verification, for Facebook verification, wherever we need to prove that we are in fact Microsoft.com because we own Microsoft.com.
Gotcha. Makes perfect sense. Well, I think that's it. We're out of time. We're actually a little bit over time. Thank you for being with us, Chris. I like to end with this comment, which I think is great. What is new in VS Code? Please explain it. Chat. That's what we've been trying to do for 30 minutes. Did we not get it right? Sorry. Listen, we do have release notes though. I wonder, producer, can you knock together a URL for that real quick? If you want to go read everything that's new in the latest release, that would be awesome. Chris, thank you for being here. Felicia, thank you for being here. Henning, thank you for being here. But most of all, Jonathan Joster, thank you for being here. And the rest of you, chat. We appreciate seeing you. Yeah, there we go. There's our updates. Check it out. Everything's in there. We even put gifts and we tell you what themes we use in the gifts too, because we love you. We'll see you back here next week for the next weekly VS Code live stream. Have a wonderful day and thanks for being with us. Bye. Yeah.